stop and open the music because I can now.
Just to bring something that's a word that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song. The song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within. The way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you, all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the pain I've made, but it's all about you. All about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one can express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song. The song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you, all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the pain I've made. It's all about you, all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. All about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the pain I've made. It's all about you, Jesus.
Microphone off to save the battery, and forgot to turn it back on. We are, next Sunday, we give a few little announcements here. Next Sunday, we are having our January annual meeting, and the agenda for that annual meeting includes approving the budget and electing delegates to the Synod Assembly and electing people to serve on the endowment team and a few things like that. So And that is going to happen. You'll have to get up a little bit earlier because it's going to happen at 9:45 next Sunday morning. If you are curious about the proposed budget, there will be copies available as you leave here today. Today's gospel text is from the Gospel of John, chapter 1. And it has John the Baptist. It's sort of a continuation of what happened after Jesus was baptized last Sunday. We see John the Baptist, who notices Jesus walking by and says, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And of course, who hears this? None other but a couple of John's disciples who decide to follow the Lamb. Then John tells us exactly what happened when Jesus was baptized. The sermon is going to be on that phrase, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." I was telling somebody before the service how devastatingly terrible last night's sermon was, because I tried to do too much. I was covering prosperity gospel, nihilism, Paul Tillich, and Rene Girard, all in one sermon. So I was out swimming in the sea. Hopefully, it's going to be much better today. Read your messenger. I think that's all I have to say.
Let us pray. Almighty God, thank you for having manifested yourself in the child Jesus, and to have led him to the River Jordan, where he was recognized as the Lamb of God. Let the Lamb surround us, envelop us, make us one with him, that we may take him and manifest him to the world ourselves. These things we ask in the name of that Lamb of God, Jesus our Savior. Amen.
Jesus is alive.
He reigns on high. Shout to the earth, he is King. Let the whole world know his name. That Jesus is alive, he reigns on high.
Together in trust and hope, we proclaim our faith. We believe in one God, blessing you pour out, I turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name, the sun is shining down on me, and the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, on a road marked with suffering, with his pain in the offering. Every blessing you pour out, I turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. My heart is yours to say. For blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart is yours to say. For blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory, O King. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Merciful God, you have manifested
as I often say, the bad news is that we are sinners. The good news is that even when we are wrong, God makes us right. Even when we have messed up, God puts us together. Love never runs out. God never tires of calling us beloved children. So here, now, here, not merely with your ears, hear with your heart, that Almighty God forgives you all your sins for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
So dear.
Our gospel reading today comes from the Gospel of St. John, the first chapter. John the Baptist saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me, because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. And I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. The Gospel of the Lord. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Share God's peace by greeting those around you. All right, I'd like to invite the young people to come forward. Henry's coming. Jude and Jonah, do you see Henry's coming? And Clara's coming? Good morning. I'm going to show you two pictures of famous people. The first one is this guy. And our parents might be able to see it up on the screen, but maybe not. Well, there we go. You think that's a funny looking guy, huh? Well, he's not exactly Brad Pitt, is he?
No.
But that is Martin Luther. Yeah, Martin Luther. He was born way before the camera came about. So that's a painting by his best friend, whose last name was Cranach. That's Cranach's painting of Luther. So we do believe he looked quite a bit like that. He's not such a bad-looking guy.
That's funny.
I guess he's wearing kind of a funny hat. Do you know why we celebrate him? We're celebrating him all year, because 500 years ago, he nailed 95 statements onto the door of the Wittenberg Church to begin the debate, and the debate turned into what we call the Reformation, and that's how this church got its start. 500 years ago, how about that? Martin Luther. Can you say that? Martin Luther. Okay. Here's another guy.
That's Martin Luther King.
That's Martin Luther King Jr. And his parents, or we could say his grandparents thought enough of Martin Luther that they named their son Martin Luther King Sr. And Martin Luther King Sr. then named his son Martin Luther King Jr. We're celebrating his birthday. There's a national holiday tomorrow for his birthday. Do you know what he did? He did something very famous. We could say that he changed at least the United States, helped us to understand how important it was to live up to our Constitution that says all people, all men are created equal, and we all deserve the same rights, no matter what color our skin is. Okay? Now, he's a great man that we celebrate. It is a shame that we know his face, recognize him much more than we recognize Martin Luther, but maybe that's all right. Maybe Martin Luther would say that was fine. All right. That's all I have. We're going to have a prayer, okay? Repeat after me. Gracious God, we thank you for great people like Martin Luther and Martin Luther King Jr. Help us to learn from them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you can go back to your seats. Thank you. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. That's our title to our sermon. Here is the Lamb of God, the whole thing. Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And we're going to look at that in a second. Let me preface this sermon with a story. I think I may have told you the story at some time. It's called The Luck of Roaring River. Roaring River was a mining camp. And in this mining camp, it was all men, as you can imagine, all men. Except one woman lived in the camp. She happened to be the cook. Well, the cook got pregnant. You know how those things happen, but she got pregnant. And when her baby was born, those miners didn't know what to do. And they took the baby and set the baby on a pile of dirty rags. And then as they looked at that baby, they were horrified. How can we have a baby on dirty rags? So immediately one of the miners went to the town to buy a crib and brought back the crib. Another miner went and found some clean rags in which to lay the baby. And then they looked at this baby and they go, "We live in a dump. This is a dirty, filthy place." And they began to clean up where they lived. And it started looking pretty good. Well, the birth of a baby, I suppose, can do that. And, you know, many preachers tell this and tie it to the birth of Jesus, that when Jesus is born, especially born in our hearts, which we emphasize at Christmas, when he's born, things we realize need to change. And is born in our hearts, God's kingdom needs to grow within it. Remember that thought, because now we're going to go on to my sermon, that I cleaned up quite a bit from last night. Agnus Dei is the Latin term for Lamb of God. And the Lamb of God you generally see pictured as a lamb triumphant with a banner, Christ's victory over death, the Lamb of God. Those cartoon strips I show you, the name of those cartoon strips is Agnus Dei, the Lamb of God. And this one happens to be on today's text. Ted says, I just noticed all these different names for Jesus in this story. Yeah, Lamb of God, Rabbi, Messiah. And then Rick continues, people use these old titles, think they know him, but Jesus will give them all a richer meaning. And Ted goes, yeah, like using one to name a comic strip. Thank you for laughing. Okay, last night I was swimming deep in the ocean, talking about prosperity gospel, nihilism, Paul Tillich, and Rene Girard. So when I skip some slides, you know I'm skipping all that stuff. Here we go. Notice, though, in this text, John the Baptist says, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Sin, not sins. What is sin? Adam and Eve. We'll go way back to Adam and Eve. And remember the story. God tells Adam and Eve, you can eat of any tree, but don't eat of that tree in the middle of the garden. And then the tempter comes by, the serpent, and places desire in their hearts. Rene Girard says, desire is not innate in human beings. It needs to be placed in their heart from somebody, by somebody. Usually the people around us that we admire. Anyway, Adam and Eve are there. Get this desire placed in their heart. See the tree, how good the fruit looks. Oh, so tasty. And you know, God doesn't want you to eat of it because then you will know. You will know the difference between good and evil. Then you will know and be like God. Now, don't you just wish there was somebody there who came and said, stop. If you seek your life, you will lose it. If you lose your life, you will find it. What we think of life is fulfilling these dreams and these desires we have. Isn't it? Oh, if I just had a better job, my life would be better. I'd be more happy. Oh, if I just had a different wife, my life would be better and would be happy. Right? Or a different car, or a different house. Or, boy, I sure need granite on those countertops, right? Oh, life would be so much better. Here's what. That's what the prosperity gospel promises. You see, they, by the way, somebody asked me to write a newsletter article on the prosperity gospel. This is what you're going to get. Prosperity gospel. Isn't that what they say? They play on those desires we have, those dreams. But what they don't tell us is that when you realize your dreams, your earthly dreams, they're hollow. Life is still filled with anxiety because our true anxiety is being nothing at all. Nothingness. I mean, don't you just wish? You want $10 million? Well, here's what I think. You want $10 million? I want you to have $10 million. Go out and earn $10 million or more. Don't forget the church in the process. But here's the devastating thing. You still won't be fulfilled. It'll still be empty. So to base a theology on... Excuse me. To base a theology on emptiness is pure foolishness. The highest rate of suicide... I just read this, so I hope the statistic is right. It comes from the internet. The highest, and let's say one of the highest rates of suicide in our country, happens to be among people over 50. Not just any people. White males over 50. They're right at the age, aren't they, that they've established some measure of success, some measure of status in society, but they've come to the point, oh, it's still empty. Another high rate of suicide happens to be among lottery winners. Our dreams, these desires we have, it's the sin that needs to be healed in our society. So sin causes our problems. And here I was going to get a little wordy with conflict and Rene Girard and scapegoating and Jim, which would be fun to get into. See me some other time. But then we come to Jesus, who John the Baptist points to. Behold, the Lamb of God. And the reason he's the Lamb, because he wants you to know of the purity and the innocence of that Lamb who takes away the sin of the world. How does he do it? He lives a life that was exemplary, and he dies for our sin, for our desires, shows us how to die even on the cross. And he tells us, if you give up your life, you will find it. If you lose your life, if you're going to try to find your life through these desires and dreams, you're going to lose it. But if you find your life, you find it by losing it first. So we go to Jesus, the Lamb of God, and he takes and heals our desires and helps us to focus on the true desire we should have, which is God and God's kingdom. And it's there that we find fullness, comfort, peace, joy. How? By serving, by giving to others. How does this work? We're going to have Holy Communion today. Surprise, surprise. We have it every week. Why? Because when you come up here, you're going to receive a piece of bread in your hand. And either myself or an assistant minister is going to say, the body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ. And we believe that Jesus is there. Martin Luther said, in, with, and under that piece of bread. And we eat it. And an assistant minister will come by and say, the blood of Christ shed for you. And we believe that Jesus is in, with, and under that wine. And we consume it. And where is Jesus? Big disappearing act. Where is he? He's in us. And the kingdom of God is growing in us. And Jesus wants to express the kingdom through us. Through you, through me, through us in our community of faith. To grow. Let me give you a couple of examples of how this happens. Tomorrow is Martin Luther King Jr. Day. And of all the things that Martin Luther King Jr. taught us, he taught us that segregation was wrong. He said things like, unless a person finds something worth dying for, they will not find life. Sounds a little bit like Jesus. Of course, he was a Christian minister. Anybody remember George Wallace? Yeah, have to be pretty old to remember him in the 60s. When he had his confrontations with Martin Luther King Jr., because George Wallace gave that, what was it, the governor of Georgia, he gave his famous sermon, Segregation Now, Segregation Tomorrow, Segregation Forever. Wouldn't allow students, black students, to go to white colleges. Wouldn't allow black students to go to white schools. Even ran for president. Came to Springfield, Missouri, packed out the town square with so many people. Somebody after church said, well, I still have my George Wallace tie. George Wallace, over the years, first his wife died of cancer at too young an age. Then he was shot by an assassin and became a paraplegic in a wheelchair and under constant pain. He had a spiritual change, though. The kingdom of God. He was a United Methodist. The kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, was growing in him. By the time the 30th anniversary happened for the Selma to Montgomery, Alabama, March, George Wallace had recanted his Segregation Forever speech. He met with Vivian Malone Jones, one of the college students he forbade to go to school. And at the celebration, the 30th anniversary event celebrating or commemorating the Selma to Montgomery March, he held the hand. Just think, two guys holding hands, two American guys holding hands. He held the hand of Joseph Lowery, Dr. King's successor as the head of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. George Wallace came to understand that all human beings are God's people. See how the kingdom grew in him? And Jesus says, let your desires die, and now desire only God and His kingdom, and let that grow. One last illustration. Tom Long, a pastor who was at the 25th celebration anniversary of the March from Selma to Montgomery, he said, beside him was George Wallace and the mayor of Selma, who was the same mayor who had been the mayor 25 years earlier. And that mayor said these words, 25 years ago, Governor Wallace and I were wrong. We were wrong. We thought this was outside agitation. By the way, if I had talked about scapegoat theory, we could have talked about that. Outside agitation. We were wrong. We did not know that it was the coming of justice. The kingdom of God wants to be born in you today, now, and forever, and to grow in you, in me, in us, today, now, and forever. Amen.
Shined among us, His glory revealed. Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glory. Day they nailed Him to die on a tree, suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sin, our Redeemer is He. The hand that healed nations stretched out on a tree, took the nails for me, living He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day the grave could conceal Him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. arose over death he had conquered. Now is ascended my Lord evermore. But death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him from rising again. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
Gracious God, help us to extend Jesus' invitation to come and see. Form us in worship into your united people, that many may see and stand in awe and put their trust in you, Lord, in your mercy. Fed with bread and wine, Christ's body and blood, make us eager to care for all that you care for, the oppressed, the despised, the forsaken, even to care for your creation, Lord, in your mercy. We pray for all the nations of the world. We thank you for the bishops of the Congo, united to begin a new season of democracy after so much sorrow. We thank you for the talks in Geneva, Switzerland, as the United Kingdom, Greece, and Turkey aim to bring peace to the island of Cyprus. We thank you for the freedom of discourse as South Korea discerns its leadership. We thank you for leaders such as Martin Luther King Jr. Help us to reach out to places around the world where the scandal of hunger still resides. Lord, in your mercy. God of healing, bring hope to all those whose life is a struggle and filled with despair. Send your healing to all who suffer, especially Braxton Bennett, Doreen Anno, Jeannie Burnell Graves, Carolyn Callen, Jeff Dykeman, Lou Graves, Ivy Ruth Johnson, Robin Kennedy, Jerry Krakow, Alan Malcolm, Chris Marquardt, Nelson Morrison, Wayne Myers, Bill Payne, Jim Raisins, Pat Roper, Jan Snath, Nellie Seward, Bonnie Turner, Rod West, Marietta Young, Margaret Peterson, Annetta Sfigera, and David Harkey. We thank you for the faithfulness of your prophets, especially Martin Luther King Jr. Comfort those who mourn, especially the family and friends of Gordon Purcell. Lord, in your mercy.
One day the trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glories will shine. Wonderful day my beloved one bringing. My Savior Jesus is mine. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, glorious day.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, O holy God, you are the life and light of all. By your powerful word, you created all things. Through the prophets, you called your people to be a light to the nations. Blessed are you for Jesus, your Son. He is your light, shining in our darkness and revealing to us your mercy and might. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his preaching and healing, his dying and rising, and his promise to come again, we await that day when all the universe will rejoice in your holy and life-giving light. By your Spirit, bless us in this meal, that refreshed with this heavenly food, we may be light for the world, revealing the brilliance of your Son, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. All is ready. Our Lord invites us. Please come. You may be seated. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, through the gifts of his body and blood, strengthen, keep, and unite us now and forever. Amen. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this gift of life. We thank you that you come with us, that you come into us, that you want your kingdom to grow within us, that you want us to leave this place and help your kingdom grow wherever we go. We thank you that you do this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now receive this benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Glory to you, glory.